Hello.
Girl Afraid! Girl Afraid! What's wrong with you saying hello? Girl Afraid! The Smiths. You're listening to Russell Brand Radio Show. We are in Los Angeles. It is not live. This has happened. You're listening to an echo from the past. Who's this with me? Trapped in a bubble in yesterday. Matt Morgan, all right?
Hello there, Russell Brand.
What's the matter? Why are you looking at me like that in your Will Self writer costume? Will Self last week on the show said, well, as a writer, you need to be anonymous. Since then, Matt Morgan has been dressed as 1, a pirate, 2, a Hell's Angel, 3, a baker.
Today, that's not very anonymous, is it?
Yeah, but it's not Matt Morgan, is it? Matt Morgan's
no,
never been a baker.
I've put sunglasses on like I normally do.
And you got your hat on as well, haven't you?
No, it just gave me ammunition to not be filmed all the time.
And your twizzled up moustache. You like to be filmed.
No, I don't.
Lovely to be in a little programme on a podcast. Or is it going to be called Vidicast? Later on the show, we've got a lot of little things to decide about. What are we going to call our new video podcast, which is sure to be a smash hit? Later on, we'll also be talking to stage hypnotist Paul McKenna.
Is he coming down?
He's going to be here in the flesh, actually live. Paul McKenna, very good friend of the show, abuser of primates. Paul McKenna will be here. Also, Lucy Lawless, the Xena Warrior Princess actress and also star of Bedtime Stories, the film I'm doing, is coming down. She'll surprise you, Matt, because you think the actress playing Xena Warrior Princess, you think, oh, she'll be a nice bit of crump, bit Dolly Bird, you know, a bit daft,
well,
nothing between
ropey.
Years. Lovely knockers. She's rough as all smuck. No, she's smart as a whip. Really, she's bright as a button.
You got a crush on her?
Sort of, but like, you know, where it's a woman where you respect them or something.
Why? Because she's a bit, you know, in control of herself.
The
ones you like.
Oh no, this won't do. I won't be able to drag her off into a cubicle and show her my pubicles. That would never.
How long ago did you do that last?
It's been a long while, Matt, since old Russie Brown.
25 minutes since he showed his willy to a lady.
Very easy to judge. Very easy to judge.
You're a receptionist.
Look, if you...
Receive this!
Am I supposed to ring that little bell with my finger?
He got told off for ringing a bell. Minutes later, he was showing his willy. As a form of excuse for his behaviour.
See, look, this is what I'm hung with.
She went, oh, God, sorry. Give me a cuddle.
Sit down over there. I'll go and get you a Murray Mint. You'll be right as well.
Does he want one too? He's about the same size.
Now, listen, calm yourself down. Little red thrusting Matt Morgan.
Red? You think I'm red because my microphone's red.
That's not why I think you're red. You're indistinguishable from it, the two of you running in one. It's like a co-joined twin in front of your face. Now, calm down. We've got a lot of things coming up on the show later today. Paul McKenna, Lucy Lawless, James Corden, Gavin and Stacey Starr will be on the phone later. Also, he's being in that charity gig of mine, isn't he, old James Corden? He'll be a lot. No, he's just going to be on the phone. He'll be no trouble.
Noel Gallagher?
Should we phone Noel?
I think we should.
Let's see if he liked
his Noel Gallagher special last week.
I wonder if he enjoyed. He's probably still high from that. I would imagine
he's cock a hoop.
He'll be cock a hoop. We'll be all over it. Right, but hold on. I've got a few emails and things like that I want to read out. Also, Matthew, I hope you ain't taken my little scrap of paper. What's got facts and figures about you? Ah, what's Matthew Morgan been up to today? If you want to text us, don't, because it's pre-recorded. You're texting nothing. If you want to email us, then perhaps next week's show, what you say will still be relevant. russell.brand@bbc.co.uk. Text us now if you like, but, you know, maybe text one of your friends. You could do that instead if you've got a big urge to text someone. I'll give you Matt's phone number. You can text him. He's always on the lookout for a new experience. What have you done to your quarters in our house? It looks like some shack in New Orleans, what you've created in our glorious Hollywood mansion.
I've done nothing. It's because the cleaner won't go in there.
Because she's frightened of you. There's all piled up
cardboard
boxes.
She likes me. We went to her grandson's birthday.
And weren't I nice and normal?
For about an hour.
Lovely normal
then
fella.
Then he turned into a dark wizard of hate and stormed off.
We gave the little brat a wee. We gave him a wee.
I've given the wee, now we're leaving. Go on, have your tacos, please. We've got to be out of here.
It was nice though, wasn't it?
I liked it in that Mexican environment. Quite nice. Mind you, weren't that poor, were they, for the housekeeper?
No. She said, I don't live in a rich house.
My house is very humble. Your house is too bleeding nice. What are we
paying you? Much nicer than we grew up in.
Much nicer. That's
why.
There was a full band there.
Obviously, that's not a normal fixture, but...
They haven't always got a band. It's not the Titanic, but they had lovely proper tables, didn't
proper
they?
Proper tables, loads of people, nice barbecue,
sort of like
big house, loads of bedrooms.
Two barbecues.
The poor here are living it up.
They're living it up the poor. No wonder this country's going to the dogs. The poor are getting ideas above their stations. It's like Paris before the revolution. They're properly living it up, aren't they?
Yeah.
What a carry-on.
But it's weird because she thought we... Because we live in that big house she up in the hills. She probably thought that's what we're accustomed to.
Just thought we were. Oh, no. Crikey. I remember when I was growing up in Long Beach with Snoop Dogg. I thought one day I'll make that trip across town, you know, up to the hills, Hollywood, buy a big car, etc., etc. But anyway, you, Matt, you're not... glad or grateful to be free of childhood poverty, but rather you're trying to recreate it with cardboard boxes on my patio.
Right, what's the cardboard boxes are from your birthday present.
Yeah, that hammock.
I just simply haven't put them in the bin yet. And they're not in my room, they're outside.
Why don't you move them across? Move them across. Well, like play real life Tetris with cardboard boxes. Why are they still outside there? It looks horrible. You've smashed a bit
There's
of the door.
There's staff at that house. You've They've smashed... done nothing.
Why have you smashed the door in?
I haven't. The door's broken.
It's like you turn into the Incredible Hulk in there. Smash things up. There's all torn up trousers.
I've got two single beds pushed together. One of them's on wheels. It's like a skateboard.
And why are those beds off pushed in the night? Together? Because when you booked in, it was as Mr. Morgan. And suddenly, I hear female voices by night. There are strange smells, unusual potions and lotions in your bathroom cabinet. Would you mind telling me exactly what you're doing in there?
Well, maybe I've got a lady friend.
Woo! Switch swoo! Matthew Morgan, lady lover. Not like old Russ. Single and available for my enormous, thriving fan base. Now, hold on, I've got something else to criticise you for. Oh, yeah, when we're on the way to do this radio show...
I just say my room's a mess, but it's because... No one goes in there to clean it. I don't know if Gabby's aware that I live in there. I don't know what's happened. I've been using the same damp towel for about 2 weeks.
They call you El Werewolf and they then go in there. They're terrified of what
happened. Have you told her not to do anything in there?
I've told her if she feels afraid of you that she shouldn't go in there. She said you goosed her on day one. She said you've been all over her.
I do bark when someone comes knocking.
She said that you tried to get her to do the Lambada on the first day. She's felt very threatened. You breathing down her cleavage. Eyeing her up, pulling
you
her
like living in there. You're always coming in, getting into bed with me.
Yeah, well, let's see how you live.
What about the other day when you were on your hammock and I put a quilt over you?
Why did you put
and rocked you?
Why did you put a quilt over me in my hammock and rock me like that?
I don't know.
It was quite nice. Like, I felt
maternal for about 10 minutes. Then I felt sort of Beverly Allitt urge.
It gave me a little shaky cuddle. Cuddled me too hard.
Come on, here we go.
Oh, my skull, my brain's rattling in here. Ridiculous.
That's being nice. I'm not very comfortable being nice.
It didn't make me very comfortable. Could you not do it again? If you're planning to be nice, could you write me a letter?
Did you like the breastfeeding?
It made me very, very, very... I was a bit turned on by it. I was astonished that you could lactate that clear fluid. It was delightful in a way. How come this morning as well, when we were on the way to the radio show, I heard you boasting to our friends, producer Jack, manager Nick, heard you going, yeah, man, we'll get there when we get there. We rock and roll. F the world like Tupac. Who gives a toss? Come and stop the chemist, I need some Bongella, I've got a lip bleed. Yeah?
Yeah.
That's not very rock and roll, is it?
I didn't say the first bit.
You were boasting and swaggering about.
It's not live, it's a pre-record, it doesn't matter if we're late.
You were acting like a pirate, and because Will Self has now sanctioned it, you were dressed as a pirate, because you're a low-key writer. Oh, I got to snoop in a doorway and listen to some dialogue.
I needed Bongella. Yes. I needed Bongella because I've got ulcers on my gum, and they're called canker sores here.
Ooh, canker sores. I wouldn't like to own up to that.
Canker sounds like someone trying to say cancer is stupid.
I got a canker sore.
I got canker.
I can't go to the toilet, but I got canker. That's awful. I don't wipe myself, I got a little red letter. I got lipstick on my butt. Now listen, canker mouth. What's up with you? Why do you think you're getting
this mouth
canker?
It's because of my brace. I've got a teenager's brace, haven't I, Nick? It's all right. If you go to sleep and you don't hydrate your mouth properly...
Or clean your mouth properly with toothpaste.
I'll clean it.
Just swagger into your little den, don't you? Kick all the fox corpses out of your way.
When are you moving out? I want to have your bedroom.
What? My quarters? My dominion?
Quarters? You've got a palatial room up there.
It's nice up there, isn't it?
I live in a shoebox full of rags.
I like seeing you in your little raggy shoebox. Well, do you want to move upstairs so you've got your own balcony and your own bath?
Like the folks on the hill.
Do you want to get up there, do you? Live it up a little. I see you.
I'm never going to live in you again.
Why? You like living with me?
I'm going to rent a flat.
Wait till I buy my glorious mansion. You'll come snivelling round. Ooh, Russell.
The other day I went to the fridge. I have to pay money every week for the fridge food.
$100 a week he pays.
$100 a week, 50 quid. Mansion. And what do I get to eat? always corn tortillas. That's all that's ever left. Corn tortillas and hummus. That's all I'm allowed. And then when I have that, he walks through and goes, tuts.
Even while he's saying this, a bag of free breakfast is being delivered under the table.
Thank you very much for my breakfast. That hasn't come from Russell. That's not. That's why. As soon as I think of radio shows as a place where I can eat. Guilt-free.
Who's pulling the strings behind all this nonsense? Some
I go shopping more than anyone else. I put the food in the fridge. Then when I eat it, people tut.
You ain't been shopping. You don't know where a shop is.
Whatever this stupid posh vegetarian food that he demands, I had one little bit of frittata or something it was called.
Keep your hands off of my frittata.
And he goes, what are you doing? What are you doing? What are you doing? You're not a vegetarian. That's not for you. That's for me. It's been designed for me. And I went, has this got cheese in it?
Vegetarians? That's for people with principles like Jack Bales.
No, because when I said, that's got cheese in it, has that got cheese in it? Am I allowed to eat that? Yeah. He's like, well, no, because it's for me. It's been made by a chef.
It's been made by a specialist with me in mind.
He's a snob. He wants to keep me down. He doesn't let me enjoy anything, and I can't relax there.
You want to keep yourself
that's
down.
That's why my quarters. I'm like a lion in captivity. I walk back and forth. All the stuff's falling out of my suitcase. I've been trampled. I'm scared. I sleep with one eye open in case I accidentally use something that's not mine.
Why would you do that in your sleep? What are you going to do?
That's why I'll be renting a flat.
Yeah.
Moving out.
I've heard you now.
I want a subsidy for my flat. Can you pay for my flat?
Not you. I don't want you to pay for it.
Oh, what? That company.
Because then you'll turn
you
up.
Out of
and
kindness.
Wherever I go, when you buy a massive mansion and live in luxury, wherever I go, you'll turn up there.
Oh, mate, when I come in, I'm lonely. Oh, mate, don't like it down the mansion. I'm scared of my garden.
I won't even tell you the address.
Oh, listen, I'll know the address because I'll be forced to pay the bleeding rent.
No, you will not.
Yes, I will. I'll be coughing out the rent.
I don't want anything else from you.
Don't you point your finger after all I've given you, after what I've sacrificed.
At what price?
If you knew half the things I do for you. You're listening to the Russell Brown Radio Show. We're on BBC Radio 2. This is a free recording.
I can barely relax. Yeah, I'm not going to tell you where I live.
I'll find out. I'll track you down like
that. I don't want any money from you. I want that to come from a film studio.
Is this a divorce proceeding? What's going on? Listen, what about you last night at my gig? Round Slash. Oh, you little horrible little rat boy you were.
No.
Oh, I don't want to spend too much time with Slash, but could I meet Slash briefly?
Then you sidled up to Slash, sat there, like, nudging your thighs against him. And then there's a bit where like, Slash has got a script. Oh, Slash wants me to play a version of his younger self. Somehow Slash...
You don't even know Slash
identifies
is.
Brother.
You think his name's Slash Gordon.
He saved every one of us. And I'd like to dedicate the next song to Slash. And he's lovely, busty Mrs. Nice looking woman,
lovely lady, yes.
Yeah, your head ballooned up again.
No, it didn't actually, it was shrank.
Nervous wreck you were next to him, and then when he goes...
it's like a hazelnut.
It was enormous, ridiculous thing. I'm surprised Richard Branson didn't clamber onto your shoulder and try and sod off around the globe. And when he offered me, he goes, oh, Russell, you need my number, we'll stay in touch because we're really connected.
Shut up.
Matt went scrabbling through his pockets like
no,
a crack dealer. Oh, I think I've got a pen, Slash. I'll take your number, Slash.
No, I didn't.
I would never abuse it. I wouldn't be on the phone.
Slash looked
time.
At me and said, hey, we should swap numbers. So I got my phone out, and then Russell got in there.
Slash wouldn't want your number.
Yes, he did.
Slash, that was a code that me and Slash established before you got to the table. When he says swap number, that means get rid of number 7, which is what you were, bring in number 8, a lovely little dolly bird, who me and Slash probably could have round-tabled. Come on, Matthew.
No, me and Slash had a nice chat for over half an hour. I regaled him with tales of rock and roll.
He
sat wide-eyed listening.
You listed gigs you'd seen him in while poor Slash struggled to keep awake.
And of course, then, on the 20th of November, I saw you again.
Now, you broke a string. Now, I believe it was a G-string. Lost it that day. Slash! Slash! Wake up, Slash!
We had a good chat. And I wasn't sycophantic.
Yeah, and who brought you over to meet Slash? Oh, Russ.
Yeah, then you
remember
shoved
that.
Me next to him. I went, move up, and he got out of the way and goes, go on, sit next to him.
Go on, mate, see if you can get off with him. He's well up for it.
He is actually one of the nicest people, isn't he?
Look at you this morning as well, because afterwards we met Justin Hawkins as well. He's ever so lovely. Justin Hawkins from The Darkness. He goes, he's really nice. And Matt goes, yeah, people are nice, aren't they? Matt discovering for the first time that
no,
people
but
are
big,
right.
Huge stars, you wouldn't expect to be nice, but they
Why?
Are. Apart from Ricky Martin, who's rude to me once.
Well, all he said was, please wear a condom.
Well, I think that's rude. Because what was he judging me on? Did I look like I had a disease?
What are you insinuating, Ricky? What are you saying? Hey, how loco do you want this VDA to be, mate? You know, give him a dose, he starts to panic. Okay, you're listening to the Russell Brown Radio Show. If you want to email us, it's russell.brown@bbc.co.uk. Coming up later on the show, we have got Paul McKenna, James Corden, Lucy Lawless, Noel Gallagher. What a show! Plus some of your favourite items like Nanecdotes, Jingle Race War, What Is It Good For? And our regular item, Gay. What a show it was as well last week. Oh, Lorraine
Brilliant
Kelly.
Show.
She was fantastic, wasn't
Sexy.
She? Oh, Lorraine Kelly. Oh, there was a connection there, wasn't there, Matt? Between me and old Lorraine Kelly?
No, not
no,
really.
Not really, no connection.
She's in love with her husband.
What about old Will Self? Oh, he was intimidating, wasn't he?
He was intellectually intimidating, yes.
Very intimidating. Look at Anthony Lawler, one of our listeners, said, you had Noel Gallagher and Will Self on the radio last Saturday. Noel is one of the world's most successful musicians. Will Self is one of the best writers. Noel reckons he writes rubbish about nothing. Will Self can talk hours about the meaning of what he writes. These two people should get married and record an album together. You need to start a new feature, People Who Should Get Married. I've started you off with Will and Noel. By the way, Will Self looks exactly like the food critic from the film Ratatouille, which is a film about a rat who makes it as a chef.
Makes it as a... Well, rat.
He's a rat, but he make well, it as a chef.
Pitch it to me.
Okay, you're a rat. You're not normal chef.
That's not a good pitch. You can't start it with you're a rat.
No, all right, hold on. You're a movie exec. He's a rat, that rat. He make it. As a chef, though, not as a normal rat, just
Can
being
you
a rat.
Get out, please.
Okay, thanks for having me in your office. Can I take this pen? Matt Morgan would at that point say hello to that executive and sidle off out of the room. There's some, and also, of course, we've got our video podcast, which will be starting soon. We've got to think of a name for it. One suggestion from Susan Gray from Ontario, Canada. Across the world, our listeners are growing. Matt, soon we'll be syndicated to the United States. Our power will grow. Our empire, the dominions, the armies rise.
Oh, God, and I'll still be stuck in a little dog's bed underneath you.
You'll be in your basket. Hello, Russell, Matt and Mr. G. Mr. G ain't here, of course. Why? Because he's swanning around West London doing cocaine off a 12-year-old's back.
I think that's slanderous.
I don't... Is it? Is it? I'd like to say that's a fictional 12-year-old and Mr. G
and there's no cocaine
doesn't
there.
Take drugs and drugs are bad. Hello, Russell, Matt and G. Here are some suggestions for naming the vodcast. This is from Susan Gray. Historical and obscure, Podkin. That's derived from Edison's early motion picture machine, the kinetoscope. How is it? Was that, what is a kinetoscope? How does that sound like Podkin? What was that thing, like a zoetrope,
Podkin?
And things that spin round?
Didn't we have an argument about that? I thought it meant body and I was wrong and you said
it was some sort of needle or something, a pin or something, bare bodkin or something.
I thought it was a type of jacket.
A bit sexy, this suggestion, this is quite a good suggestion from Susan Gray in Ontario, a bit sexy, a peep cast. Imagine it being a peep cast.
That's quite good.
Ooh, welcome to the peep cast, but a bit like Peep Show.
We'd have to say peep a lot. And
peep, peep.
I don't like people called peep or pip.
Peep or Pip, what? If someone called Pip, you don't like that?
I used to know someone called Pip.
Because you think, well, I've got to say Pip every time I talk to him.
Yeah, but why would you want to be called Pip? Yeah, the smallest unedible part of anything.
Yeah, a useless little Pip.
Hello, I'm Pip.
Pip, 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 Pip. Yeah, you don't want to be called that, do you?
Imagine your name is Pip Brand.
What about you, Pip Morgan?
Pair of Pips.
We're just a couple of Pips together. Pip, Pip. Right, we're not calling it that then. In Nasdaq...
Sorry to Pip, who I know.
No offence, Pip. Great name, by the way. And you, Pip Schofield. A lovely bunch of guys. In Nadcast, not widely spoken, Looky Wook or Vidicast. Now, I like Vidicast. Looky Wook. I know, we said it last week.
Clockwork Orange.
This is more the... We're heading towards where we go. It's called a Vidicast. I'm building...
Oh, really, are you?
Momentum,
right, okay.
Professionally.
That's why you have that golden, manic stare in
yes,
your eyes.
The manic stare is me working.
Bert from Sesame Street's on the
brows right,
there.
That's right, yes. And you have Ernie's mentality and childlike stupidity. You savantish
nut. We are a bit like them.
I suppose we are. I suppose we are, in a way, Matt. And I believe they were homosexual lovers. I think
that's what I mean. That's what I mean.
Okay, so that is why
they
I come in your
separate
fox
beds,
bed.
Though, on the show, but I'm sure when it was...
They pushed them together, like you and I have an evening. The single beds, edging together, nice.
Just wheeling it over.
Wheeling her in. If you put the wheeled one closer to the wall, the static one would hold in position.
Yes.
I've said this, I tell him this every night, then I wouldn't be scuttling across the room.
I quite like the way I can just push you off, I'm so finished.
At the point of orgasm, I go flying across, like very much like supermarket sweep. Whoosh, off I go. Or immediately after Supermarkets Week with a researcher. This is a good bit. Vidicast sounds vaguely medieval. Sea emission. Oh, I don't like that. Sea mission. No, Susan. What? No. These are all suggestions from one woman. Submission. Sea mission. Well, it says that in my
favourite. Look at this bloody thing.
There you are. That's
sea mission. No.
No. Vidicast, still the favourite. And then one final one.
Too difficult.
It could be called the Podian or Podian Theatre. Right, Podian.
This Why don't we give it an eccentrically grand name that takes ages to say?
Well, because that makes films fail. You know, whenever a film has a big elaborate title like Captain Fantabulous's Spectacular.
Eternal Sunshine and Spotless Mind?
Yeah, all right, but it's not, you know, what did it do at the box office, kid? If you want to work in this about town. I care about more than figures, you know. Bedtime Stories, it was for me very much a project of the heart and soul.
He fell in love with the script.
I've got to do this. I've got to play the part of Mickey, just a guy who responds to Adam Sandler. this is something I always wanted to do.
Careful.
It's actually quite good. So
there he is. There's the promotion done. It's actually quite good.
I'm free from my obligations to promote that film now. Quite good, Russell Brand. Yeah, hold on. Podian or Podian, this might upset Australian fans of the show because a Podian is one who feels hostile towards Antipodeans. Okay, fair enough.
Antipodeans.
Oh, P.S., says Susan Gray, and this is interesting and also the whole reason I read this email. Monday morning, I was driving a Tibetan Lama, China, get out of Tibet, I was driving a Tibetan Lama to Toronto Airport and the podcast of last week's show was playing in the car. The monk was giggling like a teenager and kept saying, crazy monkey mind, crazy monkey mind.
No, he didn't.
This look, why
crazy
would I lie?
Crazy monkey mind?
Like a monkey god or something. Like a monkey god in Buddhist culture, yeah?
That is not right.
Monkey mind!
He wasn't listening to the radio, he's just saying that because he's gone mad.
I've got a crazy monkey mind, I need another
Tell yourself, I've gone crazy. It's give irritating.
Give me a banana.
Right, okay, should we listen to a record? What's
yes,
coming
please.
Up? Well, in honour.
My breakfast is here.
Matt was. Now, you know, you've never known true horror till you've watched Matt Morgan eating a fried egg with a plastic fork, slopping placenta all over his beard because he's so disguised up as Captain Pugwash in an attempt to impress Will Self.
Well,
he can't
being
even
filmed,
live
and
his
I'm
life.
Clearly just wearing a t-shirt.
You've got a great, you've got a hat on, a beard. My face is look like an albino Craig David.
I grew the
bloody
beard.
Shot.
Buy it and stick it on.
Congratulations! What do you want, a medal? Right. So, in honour of lovely Justin Hawkins, who we met last night, let's play.
If
well,
you're famous and you turn up to his gig, he will bum lick you.
I don't bum lick. What about
bum licker,
you?
Bum one of the biggest bum lickers in
slash
the business.
Nosh, slash nosh. Slash nosh.
He's a rock star.
I'm not. Justin Hawkins weren't even at the gig. He was just next door. He's actually a really sweet, tender fella, and it makes you think. Oh, why do people in the media have pop at people? Met Robbie Williams recently. Lovely fella. Admittedly, I weren't as smitten with him as our manager Nick, who seems to be some sort of unpaid
camping. Went camping with him. Looked at the stars.
Just gazed up there, the two of them. Gazed being the operative verb. Now, why don't we now listen to? Let's listen to The Darkness, and let's all think about how lovely Justin Hawkins is for a while, right? I believe in a thing called love, and how could you not, listening to this show where love is so abundant, where joy is all around? Ah, me and Matt Morgan, what a beautiful spiritual connection. You're right, are you cleaning the egg out of your brace, or are you going to get another ulcer?
Yeah, that was a nice breakfast, actually.
Lovely, nice to see you scoffing eggs with a plastic fork. But the tone of this room cannot be lowered with your sloth-like lack of manners when we have a gentleman, dignitary, one of the most honourable entertainers in show business present in this room, Paul McKenna, I welcome you.
Thank you. That's a very lovely introduction.
That's good, isn't it?
So I'm a little nervous, you know, I'm worried. Why? That my mother might think I'm demeaning myself again by coming on this show.
That was your mother's verdict of your first appearance, wasn't it?
Yes, but that was because you started by mentioning that I wanted to have sex with a monkey.
Well, yes, but if anyone would know that of you, it would be your mother, who had to tolerate your difficult years as a teen. Teenager, those embarrassing trips to the zoo, your preposterous reaction to Keith Harris and Cuddles the monkey.
Oh, bloody mother, Keith Harris has got a very erotic creature at the end of his arm there. I've never liked Orville, but that other guy is a real hit with me.
Well, Paul, thank you very much for coming. And
my pleasure.
I'd like to use this opportunity to say that Paul McKenna, I don't know, that we were sort of, the whole having sex with monkeys thing, that was a kind of a parlour game that went wrong.
Well, he's like one of those urban myths that's got out of hand now, you know? I mean, it's who knows where it could end?
Well, you know, I think it should end just with you having fellatio from an orangutan. You are very much hypnotism's Mary Chipperfield, abusing monkeys with casual aplomb. Ah, Paul, thank you. thank you. It's nice to talk to you, because normally when I talk to Paul McKenna, it is at the end of a phone before I go on stage. Like, Paul, I'm having an anxiety attack. I've got to go on Jay Leno. What will I do? What will I say? And Paul McKenna talks me down as if I'm a suicide on a ledge of a 40-story
building.
That's
usually because I've had a couple of gin and tonics, you see, and so nothing really matters to me at that time.
It's pretty interesting being hypnotised by a drunk man. I do enjoy that. And Paul, recently I've been so amused, and it's been joyous that the occasion I spoke to you about an emotional affair of the heart.
Yes,
I met someone that I'm very fond of. Yes, I left a message. Paul,
Justin Hawkins. don't
jinx it, man. This one's special to me. Come on, thinking of you, Justin, and I do believe in a thing called love. I left a message for Paul. Like, Paul, I've met someone I'm sort of like. And that, I need some advice because, you know, I've got to concentrate on my job and work and all this sort of stuff. Paul called me back like about 8 hours later and said this exact sentence: "Hi, Russell, it's Paul. What's the matter? Some bitch twisting your melon?"
Don't out him for saying that. That's the name of his next book.
I can untwist your melon in 7 days with Paul McKenna.
I forgot I'd said that. And
yeah,
that
you
have
drunk.
A photographic memory for these things, don't you?
Yeah, things that are funny, I don't let them go. I don't let them pass.
It's like you have like a little library there that you store these things away, and then months later they can be brought back.
Oh, yes.
Psychopathic, really.
Also, I feel no empathy for others. Matt has to draw a range of expressions for me every morning before we leave the house. Okay, so the upward curve, that means happy. That's right, Russell, yes. Mimic human emotion, assimilate into American culture. Let's do a proper interview on Paul McKenna, friend of the show, a man that perhaps like Noel Gallagher we sometimes take for granted, even though they are huge, powerful, sexy stars. This title, we've got new producers on the show now, Jack Bales and Gareth Roy, who have worked with us a long while in television, know us well, but are very lucky because a lot of their work and research reveals them to be idiots. The subsections of this interview are termed thusly. Saucy is the first section of the interview that we'll be covering. I sense Gareth Roy's hand in this. Gareth Roy, who once, well, whilst in a car, all of us were together in a car, driving through Los Angeles, and this woman goes, God, I keep getting told in this city, you know, they're so hot with the parking. And she goes, I've been told 3 times. And Gareth Roy went, I suppose if you get towed 5 times, you get footed. Said that, the toes, because there are 5 toes on a foot. And we all naturally...
You shouldn't have even said it, because he's brought our show down.
We all attacked him and derided him for his ridiculous comments.
That's rightfully so, yeah.
There was silence for a minute, and he went, so what if I said that thing? As if he had a right to be an idiot. Well, this research here is the product of that same mind. The first section is saucy. Paul has helped 5 infertile couples get pregnant. Have you, Paul?
Yes, I have, actually.
How did you do that, Paul?
With your own dirty sperm. With your little tummy worms.
There was no such thing involved.
You can see Paul's got one ear on his mother listening, isn't he?
Dressed as a monkey.
It was couples that couldn't conceive naturally, and for some reason, there was a psychological blockage, and actually, I was able, it is true, to help other men's wives get pregnant.
That doesn't surprise me, Mr. McKenna, even remotely. So, people can think themselves pregnant now.
I read about a doctor who had about a 50% success rate with couples that couldn't conceive, and he was basically just hypnotizing them to relax because when people are stressed, it affects the estrogen levels. Mm. But I think there's a bit more to it than that. I mean, some of the one of the ladies, her immune system kept attacking the fetus.
And internal war. I don't like that at all.
No, well, and so...
It just thought of it as an invading presence.
As an invader. So I put her into a trance and asked to talk to her immune system and said, stop it.
I said, stop it.
How'd you ask?
I said, I'd like you to reconsider this, please. and then she had twins. It was lovely.
Oh, well done.
I know. I mean, it's, I don't have kids myself, but it's one of the most gratifying things.
Just to run through that story again, to put it to layman's terms, a woman couldn't get pregnant, Paul put her into a trance, she got pregnant. That's all I heard. There was some mumbo-jumbo about talking to an immune system as if it was a traffic warden in someone's womb. But basically, it sounds like Paul puts people to sleep like a naughty dentist. Right, Paul, also, this is the word claim is used here, which I would criticise our production team for, because it's sort of it's suggesting that somehow your work is spurious. Paul also claims he can make a woman's breast bigger with his techniques.
Well, I haven't claimed this, but because I've not done it, but yeah, there is a an actual clinical procedure for breast enhancement, and it was developed, I think it was back in the 50s, by an American clinician. There was his client had one breast bigger than the other, so he regressed her back to puberty, grew her back up, and her breast size changed, and then really? They evened out. Yeah, yeah. No. It sounds saucy and sort of ridiculous, it's in the in the literature, in the science. Psychological literature.
Can't be queried. That's it. That's
I'd say not. No. And obviously, if there is a lady that requires that kind of help, let us know.
Yes, please. It's russell.brand@bbc.co.uk. We can think your knocker's bigger in 7 days.
Yes.
Probably quicker than that.
Yeah.
Paul can get them all nice and big. I'll slap them about a bit. Matt will write a poem about it. Mr. G won't be writing a poem because he's not here. And then there's this subhead. This is the next piece of your interview. It's entitled Rich. This year, Paul became Britain's highest-paid TV personality in a deal reportedly worth $23 million. Now, I read that you're our country's highest-paid TV personality. Now, I felt, obviously, some pride, bit of envy. Now, are you Britain's Oprah Winfrey, in a way?
I'm not actually allowed to discuss any of the details of the
You want to go back to the monkey sex? You're more comfortable with that?
The lawyers would be happier if we did, I think. Yeah, I'm not allowed to talk about it all, but it's life is very good though. I'm loving it. I'm living rich here in LA. I'm loving it.
Yeah, it's quite nice here, isn't it? We're having a lovely time, except for Matt, who's turned his bedroom into a ghetto. It looks ridiculous. If you found a fox living in Matt's bedroom, you'd think the fox had let itself go. It's disgusting.
Quite a bad room. Anyway, before I got in there,
that is the pool room. Is you've got a bed in there, you've got a lovely shower, all tiled, all nice, but he's turned
it. Matt is looking very LA. I can see you've taken to it.
Got the sunglasses on.
That's because Will Self said to him, as a writer, you need to be incognito. Since then, Matt's been going around like the third man, looming in doorways. We never see him anymore. It's ridiculous the way he carries on. Hey, Paul, this is something I've been wanting to mention to you for a long time. We were out once for dinner, about 10 of us. You had a few drinks, just, why wouldn't you? A lovely man like yourself, couple of drinks. Then there was a beautiful moment where you, Paul, stood up in what can only be described as a blind panic, flapping, floundering, slapping away at your own body as if you were on fire, took off your shirt, claiming, there's a bee! There's a bee! I've been attacked by a bee!
Yes.
And you said that the bee had stung you. You took your top off in a crowded restaurant, the Chateau Marmont. The bee was never seen, Paul. Then was there ever a bee?
And this is maybe why alcohol should only be sold to people in limited amounts.
Oh, my God, there's a bee! Like he took his top off. There's a bee! There's a bee! And like the people that work for Paul had to go, there probably is a bee. Paul is hypnotising himself to see an imaginary bee. There was no bees.
It was actually a momentary act of madness. Yeah. There's no other excuse for it. Yeah.
I've put my mind in your hands on occasion. Vital moments in my life before I go out, before the Brits, had a little chat with Paul McKenna, before all big occasions. Old Paul McKenna's there, right in my little mind box.
Well, that might be why I'm able to help people, because I'm actually probably a little madder than they are.
Right.
And so their problems don't shock me.
No, I could. As long as people aren't fleeing imaginary insects, they to you are utterly stable.
I was reminded of that the next day. It was one of those moments when, when you think, oh my God, I didn't really, did I? And I do remember like leaping up and people turning around on the other tables.
Terrible. Everyone was very worried. There was a man stripping at the end of the table for no good reason.
What did you do when this happened?
I just sort of stood back and watched and thought, I hope that he hasn't planted any of this.
For Paul now.
This is the beginning of the end. I'm going to have to find someone else to phone before gigs, I better get Darren Brown's number. This is the way he's going to treat my brain. Success. According to the Sunday Times, he is Britain's best-selling non-fiction author and is published in 23 languages.
Yes.
Bloody hell.
Paul McKenna. I know. That's it. You see, you might well have slammed in there with $500,000 on that hardback and had the juggernaut of sales.
It was a success.
Oh, it's beyond successful. And I have to admit, a little envy as well when I saw those sales figures. But, when we look at the overall figure, we put all of my 7 titles together, somehow I feel a little better.
Well, no, undoubtedly. That was very much a fluke, my book. Although I've just signed a very good book deal. Have I mentioned that to you, Matt?
A couple of times.
Yeah, well, it's all very impressive.
You two having a book off. Well, if I was that rich, I'd just sit here quietly.
Yeah, I know. Celebrity connections. Paul has hypnotised a range of celebrities, including Gloria Estefan, Bobby Womack, Lulu, the Bee Gees, and he recently helped Ellen DeGeneres to quit smoking.
Well, only the last bit's true about Ellen. The others appeared on my show when I used to do those comedy hypnotism shows years ago.
Oh, yes.
They weren't sure that the hypnotism would be entertaining enough, so then powers that be in television, their confidence was increased by the thought of a pop star. It was kind of weird, you know, be doing these hypnotism routines and have to, you know, stop and you know, have the Bee Gees sing or Lulu or something like that.
You didn't hypnotise the Bee Gees then?
No, I didn't. But I have to say, they were so nice. I think amongst the nicest people I've ever met in show business.
Matt's
actually
always astonished by people, how nice people are. You should have seen him trying to fillet Slash last night at my gig.
What's his name? Guy Pearce.
Guy Pearce.
The actor.
The actor Guy Pearce, Mike from Neighbours, also is in some films as well, I believe, but mostly Mike from Neighbours. He's what a wonderful man.
You nice?
Oh, he's lovely. He's so gentle and sweet, you sort of want to give him a cuddle.
Who's the nicest person you've met since you've been... Oh.
I know how to do that. It's almost... Who's planted that? I didn't even make that decision. He's hypnotised me.
Who was the biggest surprise? You know, who was the person who was least like you expected them
to be? Well, probably Noel Gallagher early on, because Noel Gallagher's a bit like a sort of just a cuddly auntie, you know, so except occasionally we'll get a bit sulky on the show and hang up because we gave too much attention to Uncle Monty actor Richard Griffiths. You know, he hang up then. But Noel Gallagher's been a huge surprise. Who else, Matt? Have you been surprised by anyone, dear?
Only Ricky Martin, but I'm still bitter about
still bitter
Ricky
about
Martin.
Ricky Martin was rude to Matt once when Matt was an intern at MTV before us.
Dissed you.
Yeah, a little bit, yeah.
And where's his career now?
Exactly.
Right, well, look at Matt. Who's living the Vida Loca now? Matt Morgan, living in his little fox bed. He's having a crazy time.
You've got to get out of that fox bed.
Yeah, no, you're all right. You like it in there. Okay, so why don't we listen to a record? We'll listen to Stone Rose, then we'll do an item together with Paul. We'll do, like, a gay or some of the news stories, whatever Paul fancies, really. But let's listen to Stone Roses now. Stone Roses. What track was that, Matt? I was distracted.
Driving South, I think.
Nice. Well, there you go. So, we're here with Paul McKenna. You're listening to the Russell Brand Show. It's Saturday night, but in our world, we're in Los Angeles. We're an echo from your past. We've not done the item nanecdotes for a while. Paul, shall I explain to you the concept of nanecdotes?
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, old ladies or nans, they say something odd sometimes, don't they? Like, you know, they'll go, they'll get all confused, like a nan.
I've still got all my own teeth.
They'll say something like that. But say if they said instead of teeth, when I've still got all my own, I don't know. What would they, Matthew, if you've got, can you give an example of an anecdote? Why bother?
Limbs.
I've still got all my own limbs.
Let's play the jingle, because that sort of sums up the...
Actually, the jingle. Hello, there it is. Dill, crummy pipes and angels and Nancy. Things we say, we don't know what we're doing, do we? Do you see?
Yeah.
Something. See? Listeners make that. That's not us. That's not our production. Brilliant. Which is very convenient because we produce this show ourselves independently now. Saves us a fortune. The listeners do all the work.
That's
essentially.
Fantastic.
The people, like the engineer, Peter, all of the production
just
team.
Just fans.
Just people we've bought in off the street. Afterwards, we have sex with them. So, this is an anecdote. It's from Jess Turner and Jessica Goodman. Two of them have combined to make the ultimate anecdote, many would say. Dear Russell, Matt and Mr. G, though Mr. G, the poet laureate of the show's off poncing around the West End now, he's not available for us. Although, actually, I think the idea is that Mr. G is going to listen to this show back, because it's pre-recorded.
And then add a poem in the end.
And write a poem. I hope he doesn't use that as an opportunity to write something disrespectful or rude about us. Do you think he might?
He may do, and he also may have used one of his pre-prepared things. He'll try and get too much in there.
Yeah,
he won't be doing it under pressure. He's going to spend too long.
Yeah, he will. He'll overdo it. It's like when you do a drawing, and you keep going back to the drawing. Oh, in the end, like you, Matthew, when you draw like little lads with turbans and hamburgers with faces.
That's just mind spew.
Why does he do that, Paul? He's always doodling during the show, Matt Morgan.
And what does he doodle?
Just weird things like little cakes and people and apples with worms coming out of them and a little boy with a turban dancing on some swords.
Yeah, why does he do it, Paul? Do you think it might mean he's an idiot?
I think some bitch is twisting my melon.
Yes. Or he's on crack.
Yeah, I think that could be it.
On the come down from crack.
That's very much what it is. So. Crack's bad. Obviously, don't take crack. Paul McKenna's there having a bit of fun with us all.
Yes. Yes, absolutely. I'm not advocating it.
Well done, Paul. That's cleared that up. So here is this anecdote. The other week, my best mate, Jessica Goodman, and I were sat in the car going to Wakefield with my grandma, and there was a Rastafarian in the car in front of us. We were driving along, and my gran shouted out, "Oh, look, he's a Rasputin." Lots of love, Jess Turner and Jessica Goodman. Mistaking a Rastafarian for a Rasputin. Do you think that's a genuine one or a lie one?
I think it's genuine.
I think it's genuine as well. It's a genuine anecdote.
A cynical man.
Well, what do you mean? Why?
Very cynical.
I've got a questioning mind. I'm one of life's inquirers, but I'm, you know, I'm open-minded as well. Now Paul McKenna's splayed my mind open and filled it all up with junk. I'm a highly suggestible individual. So that was an anecdote. Paul, of course, you wouldn't be able to share an anecdote or anything unusual that your own mum has said, because she normally comes out and thinks, "Oh, don't go on Russell Brand's show, dear. It compromises your dignity."
That's right.
People
she does.
People won't take you seriously.
Yes, she said it demeans me. Yeah, that's right.
Is she proud of you, your mum?
Well, I hope so. Yes, I think so. Mm. Well, I mean, we'll find out. Maybe not after this.
No, it's going to certainly diminish some of the pride.
That's right.
Do you ever, say you think you've got a bit of an issue yourself, do you think, I'll just hypnotise myself? Like, say you've smoked or something, would you hypnotise yourself out of it?
You could, some things can, and some things you can't solve yourself. So, you know, you have to sort of, somebody else has to, you know, see it from the outside, really.
Right, it needs to be externalised. Ask this mainly because I use a lot of your hypnotic techniques to seduce women now. I'll just say to them, you know, come on, love, give us a cuddle.
There's a bee on you.
Take your top off. Let me twist your melon.
That's right. It's a combination of the twist in the melon and there's a bee, watch out.
What does he say to you when he phones you up? I'm really interested in what sort of complaints he phones up.
You can be honest with Matt Morgan.
I can be honest. There's no one listening.
Well, I can say.
2 million listeners. Yeah, you can say.
Well, it's usually you're not the only person who does this, but sometimes people call me before they're about to go on television and do a performance. They say, you know, I need to get. Actually, athletes do it sometimes before an event. They need to get in what they call the zone. Right. Musicians call it being in the groove. You know, it's being in the flow. You're just in that place where you're thinking all the right things. You're making all the right moves, and there's a way of doing that. So I use a technique to help people get into that. So that's basically what it is. You know,
right. And so Russell's in no way an athlete.
I'm very healthy and fit. You've seen some of my sex moves, Matthew.
Well, yes.
Rather athletic.
Never won anything on sports day.
No. Always went home empty.
So what does he say?
Sometimes I'd let me keep the egg.
Yeah.
So he phoned you up and said, "Oh, I really like a girl. Try and stop me liking her in case I have some genuine feelings."
And he said, "There's nothing wrong with that." Yeah. We don't want them twisting our melon.
No. See, Paul keeps me on the straight and narrow, away from any family life.
So do you have a lot of celebrities phone you up all the time? Oh, I've got to go on a flight and stuff like that.
Yeah. Ah, flight, because he's scared of aeroplanes, Matt is. That's
not
why
really.
He's brought that up.
Not
he's scared
to not
of them.
Get on it.
Big iron bird, white wee wee. He panics in airports, you should see him, going to himself, "Well, statistically, you're very unlikely to die. Oh, you don't need to worry about turbulence. A plane's never crash from turbulence. More nuts!
No, I'm fine, I was scared of flying, but then I read, loads about the science of flying, and you know, now I understand how it works. I'm not scared of it.
He's like Condor Man of a weekend.
I was repeating the statistic, which was that you're more likely to be kicked to death by a donkey than die in an air crash, and that was true. But in 1947,
right,
and the American donkeys,
when there was a lot of donkey deaths,
and there was hardly any flying deaths, and so the American Donkey Society are least pleased with me, and so I've had to make a donation to a donkey sanctuary to ease my guilt about this,
because Paul McKenna has been vilifying donkeys.
I have.
You want to worry about those bastard mules out there kicking people
killer
to death.
Donkeys, yeah.
Statistically, you're more likely to be raped by a donkey than to die of smoking cigarettes. Oh, you go out there condemning donkeys left, right and centre. What a ridiculous way to live. How far are we away from the news, gentlemen? Someone would let me know, surely. 2 minutes from the news. In a minute you will be learning stuff. We were doing an item recently, Paul. It's called Things What Sound Nice But Are Actually Bad. It's not a very catchy name for an item. It needs to be produced up a little bit, but you've seen the people that work for us. They're just people we trawl the streets for. So this one is from James in Staffordshire. A thing that sounds nice but bad. One of my favourite sounds nice but is bad phrases is ethnic cleansing. Sounds nice, actually bad. Ooh, a nice ethnic cleanse. Ooh,
yes.
Is that? But actually, Very racist and evil. Yeah.
We've got to collate all these because they're good.
I think global warming as well sounds cosy, doesn't it?
Lovely.
Global warming.
Because warming, and it's not a dangerous.
And also globes. Binge drinking.
That sounds bad, Paul.
It sounds brilliant.
Binge drinking does sound...
Binge drinking.
Cake.
Oh, binge drinking. Then get myself near a hive, a lovely cuddle with lots of bees. I'm like Winnie the Pooh with a jar of honey.
Binge drinking. Binge drinking sounds... Is that one? Literally, if you're an alcoholic, Paul.
Makes me want to go down the pub whenever I hear about it.
Binge drinking statistics, you're more likely to be killed by a donkey than develop alcoholism from necking neat tequila in the Chateau Marmont. That's Paul McKenna there condemning another donkey. You might be interested to know, Paul McKenna, that Matt there, Iraqi Matt we call him, is an American soldier and he served in the same battalion as Black Hawk Down. Isn't that right?
Why did you bring that up?
Well, I just like to...
You've got a bit of a crush on Matt, haven't you?
It's not so much a crush on him, but I like the idea that we've got a soldier. Because when you hear about things, you know, about like, oh, this is happening in Iraq, that's happening, someone there...
Did you ever see a man die?
Did you kill someone? Have you ever kicked over a table in a market? Oh, bloody hell! colonise the world, you can colonise my colon, you big American brute. Okay, we are...
Disgusting.
Right, come on. Right, so it's time now to learn what's going on in this dirty little circle of ours, and time for Iraqi Matt to find out about my dirty little circle. This is BBC Radio 2, online, on digital, on 88.91 FM.
Mum.
Ba, ba, ba. Hello, Paul's mum. The Kinks, I'm not like everybody else, I'm just not like them. Why are you looking at me like that for, Matthew?
Because you said, I haven't got this song, I just like listening to it.
I just like listening to it sometimes in the car park.
How do you get that song?
I don't know.
You've got people get you a song?
Yeah, someone could get me a song, you're quite right.
Do you listen to it and look in the mirror and go, I'm not like everyone else, I'm better.
I'm much nicer, look how strong I am for mummy.
I do sometimes do things like that in the
mirror. Abandoning England.
I've not abandoned England, I love that nation, God bless you, ma'am. Lucy Lawless is coming up on the show. Still with us is Paul McKenna. You're listening to the Russell Brand Show on Radio 2. We are not actually doing this now. This happened in the recent past. James Corden will be on the phone in 15 minutes' time. It's going to be a real treat for all of us. I'm just like looking at some of the shoddy... I noticed that the research for Paul McKenna just said, like, Paul has hypnotised Bobby Womack. Wrong. Paul has hypnotised the Bee Gees. Wrong. How would you... The Bee Gees... Wouldn't all say, oh,
Paul
we...
has met the Bee Gees.
Yeah, that's what's happened. But our research is so shoddy. Like, why would the Bee Gees say, we, the Bee Gees, all three of us, need to get hypnotised together? Why would that ever happen? Like, they'd never have
as
the
a
same
unit,
problem.
It never happen, would it?
No.
It's so hard being no Bee Gees. You know, like, it's like they've got a sort of a harmonised problem. Ridiculous. Shoddy research. But look at this research for Lucy Lawless, which may or may not be true. Lucy used to be a gold miner in Australia. Do you think that's true?
What?
It says there, look, Lucy Lawless, Xena Warrior Princess, used
worked
to be...
Worked briefly as a gold miner, it's probably not true. Fisher.
She's a keen fisher.
Fisherwoman.
This is probably off Wikipedia, isn't it?
People
are too lazy to do the research. Right. They go Wikipedia, and then they repeat all the nonsense. That's what it is.
It's ridiculous, really. Why do we not sack more people? That's the only question lingering now.
Well, we'll find out if those things are true soon.
We'll find out, and if they're not true, one of you is
going
to be
fired.
Yeah.
On there. That's what you can do. That.
Well,
update it.
Yeah, I suppose.
Up to a point.
Okay.
Yeah, really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, some people can change it and others can't. I thought it was a democracy. It's not.
Well, you sound like a man who's been on Wikipedia going, actually, I am the most highly paid entertainer in the whole world. No, I'm not scared of unreasonable.
I never said I wanted to have sex with a monkey. I just said I found them sexy.
There's a great deal of difference. People have bridged that gap needlessly. Bees are to be feared. A bee sting in the wrong place could kill a man.
A bee on a donkey is one of the most dangerous things.
A bee on a donkey could wreak havoc across any metropolis. Some have said that Jack the Ripper was in fact a bee on a donkey killing prostitutes in London. And I don't care how many donkey sanctuaries I have to build in Argentina, the truth must be known. We're listening to donkey hater Paul McKenna braying like the donkeys he hates from the bottom of his black empty heart. Okay, we've had the real news. Now it's time for our new item, our news or something. We'll think of a name for that. We're thinking of a name for our podcast. We're thinking of calling them Vidicast. We're pretty much going to call them Vidicast because of the book Clockwork Orange. Vidi this, my brother, all that sort of stuff. And, you know, I'll say things like Bookie Wook and that. So, Vidicast, that's where our new video podcast will be. They'll be available on the BBC website. All right, well, what do you want to call it? You said it as well. You went calling
it
Vidicast.
I didn't want to jump in with it.
You came up with it independently. It's a nice name, isn't it? Because I don't much like vodcasts, because it sounds like you're going vodka, and then you go at the end of it. So I'm no fan of that bit of language at all. No. So I'm up for Vidicast.
Vidicast, yeah, I like it.
Thanks, Paul. Right, well, that's all right then. Now it's time for our new item, news. Now, look at this stuff.
Come it's an on. Original name, anyway.
Yeah, well, look, wait, let's just see me. Oh, Iraqi Matt's all hunched over in the corner having a flashback.
He's going to the toilet.
He's going to the toilet in one of his billy cans, isn't he, there? He'll probably fashion that into something in a minute, let it off to terrify a shoe bomber who don't exist. Here we go. Here's a nice item here. Free pizza for every yob. Police have sparked fury by handing out free pizza to yobs. Officers are inviting youths to enjoy the snacks and drinks at a community centre to help break down barriers. But shopkeepers in Derby are fuming at the Barmy scheme after being terrorised by gangs of thugs for months. One shopkeeper said, "It's like a reward for bad behaviour. Perhaps we all ought to stand outside my shop and be told we're going to be given free pizza." We should all just stand outside my shop and be told that. And then, whether or not it happens, I don't care. But I just want to be told. What do you think of that scheme, Paul McKenna?
Oh, it's brilliant.
I like it. It'll cheer a yob up. People have got to build bricks. No point being horrible to a yob.
They could put chemicals in the pizza that would calm them down.
Is it true?
Yes.
That, we can't drug people with pizza, man. That's not fair.
Yes, you can.
That's how all of Matt's dates go. I could just put a chemical in this drink to make this girl calm down. She's so calm
now. She's gone floppy now. That's better.
Oh, look how calm she is. She's so calm, I can do pretty much what I like. Now to put the remains of my last victim in a cardboard box and leave it outside for collection. That's the way. He lives.
Don't.
Oh, a brilliant disclaimer there from autism sufferer Matt Morgan. Autism isn't funny, even though the film Rain Man is. Paul McKenna, do you think that's a bit wrong to give the yob some pizza, or do you think it's wrong to play classical music outside a shop or a bus stop because it stops vandalism, unlike the film Clockwork Orange, where it
but
makes
does
it
seem
cooler?
But does it? I mean, is there any proof that giving people pizza stops vandalism?
There's not really, I don't think, but it might, mightn't it? I mean, I'd be less likely to do a bit of vandalism if I had a pizza.
If you had a lot of pizza, you'd probably be so fat you then wouldn't want to go out and do anything, would you?
Can't be bothered. I'll just stay here, watch vandalism on the telly if I must have some vandalism in my life.
So it could work.
Seems like an alright scheme.
They should give them good food, because it's the junk food that's probably
getting them all wired.
Well, yeah, and just sluggish and unhappy.
Giving them blue wickeds and pizza outside a shop is making the problem worse.
Yeah.
Fair enough. Give them nice things. Spinach.
I do think they should drug the pizza.
You think they should drug
Paul
the pizza?
Paul said yes to that as well, so there you go.
Yeah. Well, you and Paul, thank God, have got no actual power to go around drugging people with pizza. It's bad enough that he can hypnotise people without letting him drug junk food. God's sake, what kind of society are you people trying to create here? Ridiculous way to live. Cat adopts rat. You interested in that story?
Yes.
Wonder what's going to happen here. The headline.
I love this item news.
What's wrong with me item news? It's good.
Cat adopts rat.
Look.
It's like a simple children's book. Come on, get
Look,
on with it.
Look, it's nice if a cat adopts rat because they're crossing barriers. And if they can change and you can change, maybe the whole damn world can change.
That's just the classic stupid news story at the end. One animal that shouldn't like another animal likes one.
That animal. Yeah. Oh, look, a pig, instead of breastfeeding
it's a
little
dog,
piglet.
Lives with some dogs.
I see a pig once, it had it off with a duck. Da, 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 bloody old news. I see his kitten, it got in his shoe. It's nice, isn't it? The Daily Mail news. Right, oh, there, look at that pup, mate. He's trying to have it off with that chicken. Happy Easter. So, you know, Merry Christmas. Hold on, though, come on. Maybe. I have a feeling this news story is going to surprise you, Paul and Matt, by being actually an interesting metaphor for something or another. A pet cat in China has adopted a rat.
Well, there it is. Thank you.
Hold on, Matt, because the story goes on. Who knows how the relationship will evolve? China, which we're boycotting the Olympics of. So there, China, if you think you're getting me and Matt out there in our PE kits, running around passing batons until you're right out of Tibet, you are mistaken. Paul, will you be attending the Olympics in Beijing?
Certainly not.
No way.
Straight to that.
The campaign is growing. I'm a bit peeved that there's rats and cats getting it on over there. That's another reason to boycott the... If a rat and a cat can subvert the whole Tom and Jerry idea, why can't the Chinese military leave Tibet alone?
Hmm? Exactly.
Come on.
That's a metaphor for that, isn't it?
It's a good metaphor. See, I knew we'd get something out of this.
Come on, then.
Right, so, in China, a cat has adopted a rat, which she is nursing alongside her four kittens. So they're all there, rats, cats, sucking up cat milk out of a cat's tits.
Well, rats will eat anything.
What do you mean? So
that's
saying
not cute,
not
that's
a,
just sad.
It's just a greedy opportunist rat sucking up cat milk. Is that how you see that?
Yeah.
That's what it'd be if you were doing it. But this rat, I think it's cute. The rat has been living with a cat since the kittens were born 4 weeks ago. The rat not only drinks cat's milk, but also plays with its kitten brothers and sisters. Oh, no, this is a cartoon now. This is lovely. Better than Ratatouille, where a rat makes it as a chef.
And the cats will grow.
Rat
the brothers
makes
and
it
sisters,
as cat.
But we'll go, they're getting bigger than me.
Uh-huh.
And they'll get all big.
They're trying to kill me.
And
oh,
he'll
no.
just become their plaything.
But this is a brilliant narrative. We should write this. We should write. We're looking for new projects. Oh, Russell Brand
God.
Plays a rat, making it against all
as
odds.
As a cat.
As a cat.
It's not as good as a chef, is it?
I suppose it's less of a jump, although they are in direct opposition. A rat and a cat is a classic Montague, Capulet, Romeo, Juliet style thing. A bit like Iraqi Matt and his Palestinian girlfriend. Iraqi Matt, the soldier over there in the corner, there he is, squatting down, still doing that poo he's been doing. He goes out of a Palestinian girl in spite of American foreign policy, which he endorses.
Russell's jealous
what,
of her.
I'd like to, a little bit of American beefcake. But I like it, you know, that he's, because when I did a joke about the war against terror, Iraqi Matt was cross because he's into the war against terror. He thinks it's a necessary thing, which he's entitled to do as part of a democracy in inverted commas. Yeah? So, the rat not only...
This
drinks...
better get better, this story, because it's still that story.
Hold on!
It's
we've
still
already...
the classic story.
No, because the rat plays with the little kittens! Did
that's
you expect
that,
that?
That's normal.
It's drinking the cat's milk. It thinks it's a cat. What about that?
There's no
hold
point
on.
In reading
hold,
that
hold
out.
On, let me carry on reading.
Yeah, now you'll make something
no,
up.
No! Look, though, what it actually says
also,
is this.
Also, the rat wears a bow tie and could speak.
Chinese scientists were astonished when the rat... became a campaigner to get China out of Tibet. It's wrong, said the rat, who's now a rat monk. A monk rat. He's become a monk rat. He got a shaved head. That China are even
shaved
in Tibet.
Head? That would look ridiculous. You've got a furry body and a shaved head.
That'd be all right.
His head becomes his body.
I like it. He'd
just have a little pink patch on his furry body.
Why are you against my little monk rat friend?
Come on, read the rest of this story.
The cat reportedly treats the rat exactly the same as a natural kittens, even though it is a monk rat campaigner against Chinese occupation of Tibet, and it's become part of her family. So what about that?
That rat's going to end up eaten.
No!
Who's witnessed this? These are just lies.
They're not... Oh, Matthew, when did you, a beautiful boy from Dartford, become so cynical? Haven't I given you everything? Everything.
I've not given you anything. Not really. Not out of your fridge. I'm not allowed to eat the food at the house.
I pay money
for it. I'm not allowed to eat it.
He's had free egg white frittatas. I'll see him scoff them one after another. You'll see him popping them in his little mouth. You're the rat living like a cat. You should be in our house, dirty little pig. Right, here's another story. Now, just see if you think this one's worth reading by the logic of cat adopt rat that we have just learned. That's the paradigm that we're trying to conform to. Pensioner destroys flat to kill ants. Do you think
that's quite funny?
Not even his own flat. He's just destroying them. Should we find out about that? Do you want to know more before James Corden comes on the phone? And then we've got Lucy Lawless coming up.
Yes,
we'd love to. BBC.co.uk.
Hopefully they're real ants.
Well, let's find out. A Polish pensioner destroyed an entire block of flats when he poured insecticide down a ventilation shaft after being driven potty by ants. Marcin Barsot, 74, used gallons of insecticide, but when it seemed to have no effect on the insects, he threw a burning towel after it. This insecticide's
towel.
Not working. Yeah, he set a towel on fire and just threw it down the vent. Burning towel. This will kill them ants. That's brilliant that he done that. He's like Iraqi Matt. That's how Iraqi Matt would have handled the problem. The explosion left the block of flats in eastern Poland ruined. Well, there you are. So it wasn't as much fun as the cat adopting a rat, was it, in many
but
respects?
But just like mentally ill person burns down flat.
Yes, it is, but much more fun to think of a pensioner trying to kill ants on a crazy campaign of terror.
Where's your news come from?
I think things before I come here, and then I say them when I arrive. It's a good system.
I thought so.
It's lovely. It's working for me. Okay, so Matthew, you want to listen to Guns N' Roses so that you can impress Slash? He saved every one of us.
But yeah.
Well, he can't be, can he? Because this is pre-recorded.
You played The Darkness.
So?
Because you met Justin Hawkins.
I like Justin Hawkins.
Who your
so
fan
sweet.
Base like as well, don't they?
Yeah, I know.
Isn't there a site that's you and Justin Hawkins?
There is, actually. It's brandonhawkins.com. Is there any point in both of them? They're essentially the same thing. That's what people seem to think, but there you go. I like Justin Hawkins. There's no dishonour in that. So, you want to listen to Guns N' Roses to impress Slash, yeah?
Yes, please. Well, actually, not just to impress him.
Because you
it's
like
a good song.
It. Okay, and what like song it. Is it, Matthew?
My Michelle.
My Michelle
I
by
think
Guns
there's
N'
no
Roses.
Swearing in it.
Oh, great. Well, he says that now, because it's pre-recorded, we'll be able to get out, and that would get Paul McKenna just to shout.
You didn't hear that.
Yeah. You dreamed that, you fool. A donkey could kill you. Look behind you. Let's listen to My Michelle, Guns N' Roses. Guns N' Roses, My Michelle. Oh, they're keen on Michelle, that's apparent. Now, we have been joined in this room. Paul McKenna's still here. He's drifted off to the sideline. He's tampering with equipment, because, of course, Paul McKenna used to work in radio, so he's all cocksure of himself, dabbling with buttons and switches and whatnot. Here with us is Lucy Lawless. Hello, Lucy. What a joy to have you. I like the way you say my name like that.
I know. It's a little bit Fawlty Towers, isn't it?
Yes, it's the way that Sybil Fawlty says Basil.
Basil!
That's how you say it.
Yeah.
You've done that from early on in our relationship. I found you quite intimidating, Lucy, I'll be honest, at first.
You did not.
A little bit, but in a very sort of sexy way, if you don't mind my saying.
Yeah, you've got a bit of a mummy thing going on, haven't you? I started reading your book. I've read 3 chapters and then I lost interest, sorry. But No.
It gets better.
It's actually unputdownable. I thought it was.
Really?
Yes, but I had to because I had something very important to do this morning.
What was it?
This.
This, oh yeah, thank God. But as long as the baton was passed to actual me from literary me.
The mummy thing.
Oh, the mummy thing. This is Matt Morgan.
The mummy thing, don't you think?
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, he's got a bit of a mummy thing going on.
He gets texts that say you've been a bad boy for mummy.
Well, yeah, actually.
Not from his mummy.
No, I've got... I've got photos of him trying to breastfeed when I was wearing this breastfeed off me.
Yeah, right.
When I was wearing a fat suit the other day and I had these huge nunga nungas and I've got photos of him dressed as a friar with like that little bald cap
he
and everything like
now.
Breastfeeding off some enormous breast.
I really liked it, Lucy.
I did too. It's great.
He's a chubby chaser.
I could feel it right through.
I think that Lucy, when she was in a fat suit, was a chubby that I could chase. But even not in the fat suit, I still
couldn't get far enough.
No, that's
enough.
Right. You were imprisoned in a sort of a tomb of fat. But listen, Lucy, this whole mother fetish that I've got, it's nothing. Yeah. Can I just clarify? It's nothing to do with my actual mother, Barbara Brand.
Come sit on my knee, darling. No, it's not Barbara's fault, no. You were just born that way, and that's okay.
It's not your real mother.
It's not like I want to have it off with my actual mum, bless her heart, poor cow. No, it's I like the idea of saying mummy in a sort of sexy situation. Now, I did get into a bit of a scenario with a bird, where she was all a bit, oh, mummy this, mummy that, you're a good boy for mummy, or mummy's boobs, stuff like that. It's very sexy. I was willing to, Paul McKenna's making notes.
Well, this is going to take hours to unravel.
it was all good, clean, sexy fun, right? But then the relationship with the girl sort of continued. Like, you know, and it was all, and she would start.
You mean after you orgasmed, she kept up
kept
the play,
bothering
and then
me.
It bothered you. Yeah.
What are you doing?
You got to stop the fantasy right there.
You see
okay?
This effluvia? Well, this is an indication that your time is up. So like, well,
next.
She said, "Ding dong, a little bell rings. Someone else strolls in." Right, but all that she was texting me. Sometimes all sexy things. Oh, mummy wants you. Mummy this. Mummy that. Then she started to go, "Why have you not texted mummy back? You hurt mummy's feelings. You're a bad boy for mummy." So I'm like, I don't want to be this mummy thing going on now that I'm getting told off. The sex was removed from it, Lucy. That was no fun at all.
I know she just, you know what? She needed to learn that lesson.
Here we go, Lucy. Let's learn some stuff about you. Lucy, we've got a prepared interview here so we can interview you in
In case we run out of things to say to each other.
I can't imagine that would ever happen. You sat there with your
maternal
energy.
Shoot.
Lucy.
And the bosoms everywhere.
Oh, stop. Lucy worked briefly as a gold miner. Is that a lie?
No, it's not actually. I worked for a gold mining company in the outback of Australia, and it was, and there was nothing else to do, so I got knocked up.
You got knocked up?
I did.
You got all preggers?
Yeah, I did.
How old were you?
I was a mummy then, 19.
You were a mummy at 19?
Yeah.
All lactating, like a mummy would. That's pretty remarkable.
Stop it,
stuff.
Russell, you're bringing it on.
Sorry, I do apologise. What do you mean you had a pickaxe?
Yes, and a canary in a cage and a little, candle on my head. No, we didn't. It doesn't work like that anymore, but I'm not going to spoil a fantasy.
Right, okay, because I'm quite
I did have a shovel, though.
Did you have a shovel?
We did have to shovel and drive through the outback and sample, you know, the wares.
Wares in a...
Oh, pie man, whoever should walk by.
Right.
And they would take samples of dirt and then they'd assay it and find gold in parts per million.
And this was just billion. As a teenager. Pretty soon after that, you got pregnant.
Yeah, that was my only way out of the desert.
Lucy accidentally exposed one of her breasts as she sang the US national anthem.
False! It was no accident!
Really?
No, it was totally an accident, actually. I wasn't selling a bloody album or anything.
Right.
Plus, I'd been offered a lot of money to do it on purpose for Playboy.
Did you not do
and
it?
And turned it down. So why would I do it for 20,000 beer-soaked hockey fans?
For nothing.
Yeah, I was much more embarrassed because I sang really badly.
Can we just
night.
Talk through it a little bit? What yeah. were you wearing and how much boob come out?
Apparently both of them did, but I kind of was too. I was mortified for days afterwards.
And how would a person find that on YouTube?
But I didn't know that. Like this, pink.
YouTube, just put, what would I Google to get that up?
Oh, I don't know. I'll just show, listen, mate. Look. Oh, all right,
man.
It's over.
Oh, God, she did show me some boob then.
Yeah.
Oh, it's really weird because,
get that
Lucy
down, you big boy.
That.
Wrap your laughing gear around that.
I would wrap my laughing gear. It wouldn't be laughing gear no more. It'd be serious gear, saying serious sexy things. Good boy for mummy. Good boy for mummy. Wait. What? That's more than enough of that sort of stuff. Okay, so that's a good thing for me to look out for.
Yeah.
Now, we'll remember you being Xena, Warrior Princess.
Thanks
right?
for not putting a the in there. Xena, the Warrior Princess. When I hear
Warrior
them say
Princess.
That, it means
Xena.
Making stuff up. Yeah. Anyway, yeah, go
We don't
on.
Need a
Oh, I loved
article.
You as Xena, the Warrior Princess. No, Xena. You didn't, you big liar.
Xena, the yeah. Warrior Princess. Yeah, but you're okay. actually Xena, Warrior Princess. Yeah. I always thought, when I see that sort of thing, oh, the bird, shoot her, she'll be just a daft sort of Dolly Bird type of character.
Did you really?
Well, yeah, of course. Oh, Xena, Warrior Princess. Nice. You just think she'll be some sort of accessible floozy.
But you never got in. You never got one in.
No. But you've been married and pregnant.
Us canoodling.
No, well.
Somebody got in.
Hold on. No one actually got in. You're
it's
all...
like, watch this ink get into this chalk. Remember that ad?
No, I don't remember ink getting into chalk. That's not the way I live my life, dear. It's much more conventional.
It might have been an Australian ad. I'm sorry.
No. Yeah, I think so. I think that, yeah, that's not crossed the water. That's a bizarre idea.
And yet the chimps moving a piano did.
I don't know. What is that?
PG tips.
Yeah, no, that was, yeah, but that's cruel now. We've banned that. And please don't talk about monkeys in front of Paul McKenna. He sees them very much as erotic little beings. To him, they're just hairy lap dancers asking for it. He once admitted, Paul McKenna, on this show, in a parlour game type situation, like, which animal would you have sex with if you had to have sex with an animal? I said a tiger. Matt said a flamingo because of its elegance and he'd like to get in its egg hole. Paul said a monkey, and he said that when he watched Planet of the Apes starring Helena Bonham Carter, he said it really got him going. And to him, that's like two girls, one cup. But none of that, he loves it. He's really into it.
Have you seen, did you see the chimpanzee?
Yeah.
Did you see that the documentary about the chimpanzee?
Yeah.
Oh, what? Come on, Paul. Junior McKenna. Chimpanzee. They reckon somebody got nasty with a chimp at some point. There was some sort of a hybrid born.
And you think, what? Something was born of a
chimpanzee. It's that bald kind of half standing up.
Yeah,
so is there actually any evidence though? Is there a half man, half monkey?
Oh, I saw pictures.
Yeah, of the thing. Yeah, we've seen it. Lucy gestured to me at that point that I might be the living embodiment of a liaison between a chimp and a human. So, no.
It's the way your bottom gets red.
Yes, I know. I wish I had more control over that, Lucy. The chimpanzee, what, me and Matt see this brilliant thing on the internet of a chimp, right? It was a naughty little chimp that escaped from a lab. He was running through a suburban neighbourhood. He's dashing about, and the camera's sort of following him in like reality footage. Way, oh, there's the monkey.
Is
there
terrible.
It is. The chimp. Then they caught him behind a van. He had a cat.
He was shagging the cat.
I've seen that.
And like, he looked like he knew it was wrong. When the camera came, he sort of looked out the camera, sort of embarrassed, like he was Renee from Hello Hello, being caught with one of the waitresses. Looked up and went, whoo! Like that, and just threw the cat down on the ground.
I'm just saying, ran off. It's really bad.
The cat looked all embarrassed.
The cat was
yes,
in
where did he learn
pain.
That trick, McKenna?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, McKenna.
Yeah, it's all learned behaviour. He didn't think learned. Of that on his own.
How would a monkey dream that up, you dirty devil? Getting inside
all right, all right. I am somewhat thwarted by that.
Lucy Lawless. Let's just look, I'm looking at some more facts about her. Lucy appeared as a superpowered version of herself in The Simpsons. Remember, we all remember that happening. You was good in that. That comic book guy imprisoned you in something. I liked you when that
Mylar,
happened.
Mylar, apparently.
Also, you was in Curb Your Enthusiasm. What was that like?
Yes. Larry's my number one Jew. I grew up a Catholic girl, so to me, Jews were always like, ooh, a little bit Jesus-y, but not, and kind of hot, and never met one.
You've never met
one. We really didn't have them in New Zealand. So when I came to the States, it was very exciting. When I was 13, I wagged school to watch Yentl.
What
you know,
is
Barbara Yentl? Streisand directed that movie. And I was like, oh, my God, these Jewish people are
You were into it. Judaism.
Yeah, I was like...
What was it? What did you, Mandy Patinkin
looking hot.
What do you like about the Judaism and the Jewish folk?
I don't know. I don't know. It's just, it was just an iconic thing. It doesn't really stand up to scrutiny, really.
Right. But, is it sexual?
I think there might have been a penis thing because, you know, the circumcision.
I'm prepared to chop off a bit of skin for a liaison.
Have you got a skin?
Yeah, no, we in England, we're not, we'd leave it there.
Yeah.
Mostly. Matt, you still got yours, haven't you?
Oh,
dear?
Yes.
Paul McKenna?
Yeah, definitely.
Still Russell's there. Got a too long one.
Let's not criticise my genitals. They are very, very beautiful.
No, that's a good part of the show.
Do you know what? It's almost an item, criticise my genitals. Very recently, my penis was described as handsome in a lineup for a trial I'm involved in.
Yes, thank you, Mummy.
Compared to John Merrick's thumb.
John Merrick's genitals were perfectly formed.
I said thumb,
because
I know he's got, and he always says that.
John Merrick did have perfectly formed genitals. So
I know, Russell.
The
elephant man. A bit of a shame, though, really, because he didn't get much opportunity to use them. You can't just go up to people and say, my genitals are perfect.
I am not an animal.
That's him.
McKenna, get away from me. I'm not an animal.
Good job we weren't the monkey man, whose then perfect genitals would have come in good use with balmy hypnotist Paul McKenna. Here, Lucy, have you got any problems that you want McKenna to interfere with? Because he can get to the core of anything. He can make you sleep better, drive better,
anything. I'm quite excited about that. Oh, the possibilities.
He makes me more confident and powerful. Well, that's what he does for me.
Well, I was in London recently, and I was quite amazed to see all those people standing about in puddles in their suits with a big flagon of beer in their hand.
What's going on there?
I wish I could drink beer. They look like they're having so much fun, and I just hate that stuff. It tastes terrible.
What, so you want to be hypnotised into liking beer?
Yeah, I would like to be a bit more English.
Well, we can probably do that.
Give me, put a bit of English in me.
Lucy.
Quick. Oh, thank you, Russell.
Right, well,
Russell,
you could come round for an extensive course of therapy then.
Hello!
Hey!
You'll be pregnant.
Yeah, he can get people pregnant.
He'll ask me, would you swing from that bar? Would you eat a banana?
Okay, Lucy.
Whatever makes...
Don't shave for a couple of days. It's get you prepared for the McKenna experience.
Do you really do that? Do you really, you know, do privates?
Private
It'll do your private
session.
I would
do your private session for you, yeah.
Oh, Paul. Oh. Never seen you quite like this. This is another side. I mean, we've all got crushes on Lucy Lawless.
Of course.
Perfectly natural, but we're not all trying to hypnotise her into having sex with us. That's where the distinction lies with Paul McKenna.
I have been caught out now, I admit it.
Oh, he's awfully gracious to go along with us, isn't he?
He's a real sport. Right, okay, let's listen to a record now. What have we got all down in the old record bank? Have we got anything lined up, Gareth Roy, there in London? Stick the jam on. Stick the jam on. Bang them on. This is the jam. We'll deal with Lucy Lawless, Paul McKenna. James Corden might be coming on the phone later, although it seems he might be a little bit unreliable, but we'll get by. That's the way it is. As long as he turns up to that charity gig, James Corden may be coming along the show. We don't know. This isn't the jam. Here they are, the jam. That was the jam. We're here with Paul McKenna, and of course Lucy Lawless is here lighting up our lives with her aggressive sexual energy. See, you've got aggressive sexual energy there.
Have I really?
But you're happy in your marriage.
I know that.
Yes, you bloody well do. You're happy in your marriage, of course. How long have you been with your husband, Rob, he's called, isn't he?
13 years.
13 years, ages, ages and ages. Yeah. And it's all right, is it?
Cause good.
Sometimes it's very hard to commit.
Do you have trouble getting rid of some of these broads sometimes?
Nah.
He tried to bloody rope me into this like I'm his Judas sheep. Like, go and effect an introduction with that girl, half-naked girl.
We tried to use you to pull a woman.
We were doing a scene, right? And there was a lot, like, it was at a swimming pool party. I was dressed in a grass skirt and a coconut bra, very much like Baloo from The Jungle Book. I looked great. There was lots of
careers doing well.
I'm on top of things. You'll be playing the part of an idiot. So in this pool scene, like, there's loads of extras, glamorous extras, all sort of in bikinis, all top birds. I wandered over at Lawless. She similarly was dressed in a coconut bra and everything. I goes, yeah, help me chat up some of these birds, Lucy. She came over me to chat to this gorgeous extra. She made it much worse than it would have been anyway. She kept saying things like, oh, Russell, you idiot, and like sort of insulted me, undermined me. The extra in the end called the police. It was ridiculous.
Oh, no, I think you got her good. She was following you around a bit.
Mm.
But I did go, they did a lot of B-roll for the EPK, the electronic press kit. Yes. And they were interviewing me. I was very last after Russell and Liz started doing this stuff, right? And so I went in there
but
and was just...
But you don't let that trouble you, I noticed.
Just, I was on about, oh, Russell, he's made up this incredible persona about Russell Brand, but actually his real name was Bland and he came from the town next to me.
And they believe it still. They so totally the people that do it, they're on set all the time doing interviews that are distributed at the release of the film. You know, like when you see a pre-recorded interview on like a show. Yeah. Like, they all think now that I'm like a character actor from New Zealand.
His quote-unquote heroin addiction.
All of the ill she thinks is all made up. She's told him it was all made
gold
up.
Gold mining addiction, it was.
Right, and also she said that I was in Xena Warrior Princess playing a mute cyclops or something.
A mute centaur. And he was on a mission to find his voice. And I'm very pleased that he has graduated to a part with words.
And because it's also plausible, they believe it now. Now I'm undermined and now I can't have sex with none of the extras. They'll think I'm some schmo. It's quite good, really. I quite like my new life as an out-of-work sort of struggling
anonymous person.
It's all right. It's working out okay for me. I can do it. It's, you know.
Well, I have blazed a trail for you.
Really? Yeah, you have somewhat. Thank you. I appreciate it. I won't be involving you anymore in my seductions. I'll just get on with it on my own, if you don't
mind.
Oh, no,
I'll be good next time. True.
Do you want to help out on this item that we do on the show called Gay? It's where we help people with gay problems. Do you want to help?
I'm good.
It's got a jingle. Here it is. Gay! Made by a listener, that. That's good, isn't it? Lucy, if you nod, it does not convey well in this medium. Far worse for you to stick your fingers up at me. Here is a gay problem. Right, okay. Let's have a look at this. My girlfriend tries to act normal. Oh, looks nice. Okay, this is from Nathan Nicholson. This is his gay problem. Dear Russell and Matt and everyone that's helping with the gay problem, Paul obviously will need you to help with this at some stage. Just to make it more interesting, imagine this is a liaison between a gibbon and a chimp. Dear Russell and Matt, I'm a male student. I've been going out with a girl for about 2 years. Last week, when I came to her house, another woman who I'd never met before was there, and there were signs that ours your father had been in the making. The sense that neither female was fully clothed upon answering door, hasty excuses were made by both parties, and my girlfriend tried to act normal, but I'm worried she's secretly carrying on with a lesbian relationship behind my back. Shall I confront her with this? Should I assume there's actually nothing going on? I'm at a loss here. Please don't just say catch the matter and join in like you usually do. Because I've already thought of that and it's a serious problem. That's from Nathan Nicholson. He's got a problem. Only we can help. Lucy, what's he going to do? This poor boy, is she a lesbian? What's going on?
I just
on?
Think he's been so shut out.
He's been shut out of a lesbian
relationship.
Maybe
she was just trying you on for size. What's his name?
Nathan.
I think she's Nicholson. Just trying you on. She was just going through a straight phase.
Right.
And if you can't join in, man, beat it.
Why would you not want to? Well, I think.
Why would you not want to join in?
Yeah,
I know. I mean, I'm a little surprised that they didn't.
Lucy, you mustn't
hide it.
Come during the broadcast.
I'm looking at you.
So turned on by the problem.
I'm looking at you. You know,
Lucy,
your semi-tumescence.
Lucy,
I saw him through the slats of his window the other day.
She peeped through my hotel room. She saw my lovely genitals through through the window.
Like a Sharpay.
Lovely, she thought they were.
The brown turnip.
Listen, it's a gorgeous thing. I'm going to have to put photos of it on the internet
now. There are photos of it on the internet. Some people have actually, you know, zoomed in far enough to see it.
There are some experts at Pixar that are able to pick it out.
What do you think about Nathan's problem?
As Nathan has predicted, I think just have it off everyone. You know, so, like, why? What about
What's
you?
His problem?
It's not a gay problem.
I
it's
not really
problem.
Gay.
It's just a girlfriend. Cheating on you.
Don't, if you're worried about this bird cheating on you, mate, knock it on the bonce. That's
or
my advice.
Or hide somewhere in a sort of tree costume or post box.
Oh, that's great advice, that. Hide in a post box while I shuffle about in it. She'll notice the post box is moving.
No, she won't. She'll be kissing.
She'd be too busy doing lesbian stuff, wouldn't she?
No, I'd hide in the
scissoring away, clamping it up.
Banging donuts,
Banging donuts, that's what Lucy calls it. Lucy, have you ever done some lesbianism?
Well.
Come on.
You know, had a go, but everybody thinks, because of my aggressive sexuality, I guess, that I am...
You're up for it.
Yeah, because I have a big lesbian following from Xena.
You have the lesbians.
Didn't you know that?
For
your research sucks, man.
Well, why would I know
that? It does say
that
on because that piece of paper.
Where? Show me. Paper.
And it says because
Dicon, mate.
Dykes.
And I love them. They're the best fans.
Why?
Ever.
Why are they so good at being fans?
Your only gay problem is if you don't have them as fans, because that's the only gay problem there is.
We got gay fans. That's why we do a whole gay item for our gay fans. Look at us.
I'm troubled by this guy because he says it really is a problem. What is this, a religious problem? Why? You shouldn't even be listening to the station.
Yeah, yeah. What's the problem with that?
What's your problem?
Hold on, Paul might be able to help. He's got a brilliant mind. Paul?
No.
Well, Dom, we've got another gay problem. No. Perhaps this one's a bit more gay. This one's from Alex Anderson. The subject, Alex Anderson. That's nice. His gay problem is this. He's addressing all of us. My name is Al, and I've recently discovered myself to be a homosexual gentleman. I've recently started going down gay clubs to meet gay guys. However, I've not told anyone that I'm gay, and I plan to keep it under my hat until I'm ready to tell people. Don't keep it under your hat, mate. You'll confuse folk. When at a gay club last week, I bumped into my friend Ian, and to my surprise, I found out he was a gay. He then mentioned maybe getting together and going out for a bit to do gay things. Whilst I was flattered, I did not find it to be my type of gay. While I still want to be my friend, I don't know how to let him down without hurting his gay feelings. Could you help me? Al, Bournemouth. Well, that is a gay problem. That's gay, all
that
right.
Is a well, proper gay problem.
It's a proper good gay problem.
What kind of gay guy is... He must be one of those guys who wants to settle down and have a monogamous relationship.
Boring gay.
I mean, the other guy. So if he's like every gay I know, they're very fluid.
Do you like fluid gays? Like the ones that are up for it? Scene gays? Fluid.
Well, no, but they handle traffic pretty successfully.
Right, right. They can deal with the high numbers. That's why I think it might be a like good you. Laugh to be gay, because then, you know, you don't have to worry, oh, come on, let's keep it up, oh, pregnant, oh, you know, it can go on for, there's so many problems. You're gay, you both know what you want, you're at it. Now, yeah, so don't get trapped in a domestic relationship. Mafu?
That's weird, isn't it? Because if you were, that's like going, oh, we're go, we've got to have sex now.
Yeah, that's sexism.
Like if you bump into a girl that you worked with a couple of years ago, you don't go, oh, she's heterosexual, I'm heterosexual, oh, God.
Well, we might as well just do it.
Yeah. It's strange.
Yeah, it's strange.
Why can't they just be friends? Why can't they go to an art
gallery? They could be gay friends, but don't you think if you are gay friends, just do some bumming? You know, I can see both arguments very clearly. Yeah. So, oh, Paul McKenna's undoing his shirt. What, have you seen a bee? Are you all right, mate? Or have you got any advice for this one, Paul?
No, I think the bumming advice is probably about right. You know?
Yeah,
I'm going to go with
he would have said that with any problem. Yeah. Anything. If I'd have said, Paul, I'm nervous before a gig. Bumming. That's what he says. Anything you're addressing with, it's the solution to everything. Oh, yeah, I think Matt, once again, has been the voice of reason, because he's saying just because they're gay, why should they have to have it off if this lad, Alex, don't want to do no gay things? So, yeah. What? Don't
I'd like
bother.
To have seen the moment where they both saw each other in the club.
Gay club.
Like
that game Werewolves, where you and I, where like everyone shuts their eyes. Some people are nominated werewolves. Then it goes, okay, only the werewolves may open their eyes. Me and Matt opened our eyes.
That's
saw
what him and Ian in the club.
That's
their eyes opened at the same time.
Yeah, oh, it's romantic.
They met. You know, in America, they have this thing of, because the gene pool's so huge, I suppose, they date many people, much like you, Russell, but where I come from, like, I guess the gene pool's so small, so it's very monogamous. Even when you're going out with somebody, you're not bumming somebody else.
You never bum another.
No, you never bum another. It's one bum at a time.
Right, fair enough.
He should just get American, man. Just relax.
He's in Bournemouth. He can't get out American. He's in Bournemouth in England, poor sod. It's a miracle he's allowed to be gay down there.
Right. Do you think he's a plumber? That's why he has to keep... You know, yeah, it's hard to be gay still, eh?
In some situations, it can be a bit tricky. But I think what we do is say, look, just stay friends with him. And maybe, as you're just newly gay, have a quick go to see for learning gay tricks.
No,
you might know some gay techniques for you.
Can you hook me up with some guys?
Yeah,
hook me
Matt,
what?
You sound like a fully fledged member of the gay community there.
Well, hook
that's
me up with some guys. That's the sort of lingo.
That's the sort of thing Freddie Mercury would have said. Hook me up with some guys. Don't stop me now. Charged about all white bits in his moustache, and I meant cocaine. Then I wasn't saying anything mucky. And apologies to Freddie. And his memory that I've just desecrated. Right, so come on, hold on a minute. We've got some emails, regular emails from the show. Perhaps should we play a record? We could listen to The Who, then we'll...
We've got 5 minutes left.
We've only got 5 minutes left. There's no time for records, plenty of time for emails. And here is one such. This is about... This is about... You know, in my bookie book, there's a bit where I talk about when I had gerbils. Matthew, don't do that in front of Lucy Lawless.
Oh, don't break out the... Don't bust the gerbils.
He stretched his balls in front of Lucy Lawless.
I saw you pulling them down a bit.
You saw your little guilty grin. And when I came in and seen this morning, he goes, I like scratching my nuts. I go into a trance. That's what he was saying.
All men do.
They don't all go into a trance.
Is that how you put people in a trance?
You can't stop.
I've not actually used that method myself. We'll definitely be trying it.
There's something worth having a look at. Russell.brand@bbc.co.uk. How do you entrance people? Perhaps it's by scratching your balls. Who's to say? My gerbil gerbil story is this one. As a lad, I bought a gerbil. It was pregnant. It had a load of gerbil babies. They begat more babies. Then they started eating each other's babies.
Oh, this is an item terrible. Where Russell mentions the gerbils.
Look, it troubled me.
Lions do that too, though. Eh? Lions come in and like get rid of the other lions'
babies,
cubs.
So that that woman will go all preggers again.
Mothers have to hide them. Yeah.
So if people do it, though, we're only responding to natural urges
like
in a way.
Like Entwistle.
Huh?
Like Entwistle. I'm
who's
Entwistle? To the television. I TV 6 hours a day of this trial of this
you're
English
obsessed
dude.
With this trial, an obsessed English fella. I think the trial's still ongoing. Probably, do we have to be careful about it? Probably.
Small chance he didn't do it. But
we could go either way. We don't know because the trial is ongoing. He could be innocent, Lucy. Stop yes. questioning the justice system in this lovely fine yes. nation or
yeah,
any
what?
Nation.
Okay, yeah.
Could we have a revolution? We'll deal with it all then.
Here's another gay problem.
Here's an email. There's another gay problem. You can't just spend your life thinking about gay problems, darling.
That's all I have.
You've got plenty of things. Going on. Ain't I good at acting? I am though, I know though. You've seen me do some at work.
Oh no, you're a wonderful actor.
Thanks, see?
You're a wonderful artist.
I told you everyone. I told you I could do it.
Yeah,
see?
Of course.
I'm as good as the other boys.
Did you learn
I
your
come
script?
From syndicated nah. television, so didn't I am so. No judge of these things, but you know.
Oh you are. Oh you're a lovely performer. I'd like to work with you again. When I say work, I think we all know what I mean. Sex. Hi Russell and Matt, says Andrea Rose. After listening to your gerbil story again and again and again, I thought I'd tell you mine. My two hamster boys turned out to be one of each, and we ended up with 13 hamster babies. As it was summer, we moved the cages into the garage while we tried to find homes for them. When we got up one morning, we were met with the horrendous sight of our guilty-looking Labrador and only one tiny baby hamster left sitting in the corner of the cage. The other 12 were never seen again. Love the show!
After that, I wouldn't be able to love the dog.
No, I think you murderous man. Dog.
Murderous Labradors.
Horrible things
they
to
must
do
have
that.
Been squeaking when he ate them.
Yeah, and he chomped them all up just like they were his dinner. All their little legs and eyes. Oh, all those
nature's
bits and bobs.
Horrible, isn't it?
Nature's cruelest mistake, eh? Carnivores, the brutes. That's why I'm a vegetarian with all my principles and everything. That's why I'm so nice to everyone.
That's why you can't eat his food. You won't share the food.
I'll share it. Three egg white frittatas I give him. Never enough, Lucy. He just wants and wants and wants. He's the
I'm still troubled by the Labrador eating the gerbil.
Are you, darling?
Yeah, why, it's terrible.
Well, we'd like to go have a woman like you. What would it be like? Would you look after me? Could you ever love
no.
me?
No. Well, no, I do love you. I already love you.
But
look
would
after
you have
no,
me
I
as
don't
a boyfriend? What would it be like? What? What do you mean?
I can't see that on that.
Because of the mummy thing.
Because of the mummy. What do you mean? What about that? What's wrong with the mummy thing?
I don't know, but I imagine you'd want more of a
oh, I struggle to mother
man.
My own
hold
children.
Hold on, I'm a man. I'm powerful.
What?
Of course I am, me empire, well, me gorgeous
got,
empire.
He's got a costume like Wee Willie Winky that he puts on. He goes, Mummy. Like that. That's how he has sex.
That's perfectly
hops
natural.
Hops up onto your lap.
Flying through the locks. Let me in. Now, he gets all these birds doing booty call, which I didn't even know what that meant, but that means they ring you at 2 o'clock in the morning. It's like,
so no.
Got their beer goggles on, might as well go shag bloody Russell.
Now, listen, beer goggles isn't required for that experience. Just regular goggles. Look, why don't we listen to a record of The Who, then we'll wrap up this show. What? Because you don't know how the timings. I listen to things in my ear. There's not enough time for The Who.
I'm aware of the timings, mate. Look.
What time is it then? How long's left on the show?
4 minutes.
Okay. Well, then let's say, at this point, this is where we would insert Mr. G's poem. Mr. G is the poet laureate of the show. He summarises everything that's gone on. He'll mention Paul McKenna and all these escapades and bee fears and monkey sex. He'll mention Lucy Lawless and the mother fetish, I imagine. Matt Morgan living like a little rat, eating, stealing my food. He'll mention that. He'll mention me and my glorious march through Hollywood, how I astonish people with my endless, endless campaign for glory. So that's
there's no need
probably
to do a poem
there.
Now.
You stole his thunder, man.
It's quite nice the way I worked that all together. So well, that would be inserted about here.
Then but we don't want him to do a speech before or do anything. Build
no
his
speech, Mr. G. Don't take advantage because it's
just
a pre-record.
The poem there.
Get in there, do your poem, and shut up.
Do it now.
Past the remnants of very large stars is a horizon of events viewed from near and afar. Times distorted, a pre-recorded echoes exported. A pair of pips exchange quips over fridge etiquette aborted. Of course, Paul McKenna loves the crazy monkey tender. Orangutan memories expanded, melons twisted forever. Fleeing from bumblebees, apologies to donkeys. There's pizza to put yobs to sleep unless Mama Lawler speaks erotically. Oddly, Lucy's in the mine with miners. Monk rats and cats provide the track to field to China. Meanwhile, I'm arriving to find those in different time zones, gloriously marching through Hollywood and exposing my prose.
There. All right, so that was Mr. G's poem. We all just heard that.
We should clap.
Woo! Hey, well done.
Wow.
Hey, what if we're applauding this and he was rude about us? What then?
And how did he rhyme orangutan like that?
Yeah.
Just put loads of pressure on him.
That's good. Really hard to rhyme orangutan.
And he did it all in French.
All in French. And references from Shelley to W.B. Yeats. Incredible.
Good work, G.
What a brilliant poet he is. And I know how incredible that he chose to do it with his trousers and pants down, parting his little butty cheeks, going,
which you can
boy.
See on YouTube.
That's
he
on
really
YouTube
did it.
Now. Well done, Mr. G.
Who's a monkey? Who's your little monkey?
That's all up there. Well done. Very bold. You're a very, very noble poet. You've not compromised yourself there at all. So that was lovely. Only time now, really, to thank all the people that have participated in this wonderful show today. Well, let's look at our guest. James Corden didn't come on. Let's have James Corden on the very next show. He'll be a fantastic guest. I've got absolute confidence in that boy. Blimey, what a gift. But let's thank our actual guest, Paul McKenna. Thank you.
Thank
Paul,
you. No, you the pleasure is mine.
The pleasure is yours. Paul McKenna will be appearing at San Diego Zoo later on.
In handcuffs, with a blanket on his head.
A British hypnotist was apprehended today. One witness said, I was terrified.
I cried.
He knew no boundaries. Well, it's a kind of monkey magic. Thank you very much. And Lucy Lawless, the feminine energy you brought to- Oh, blimey. Make me want to be such a good boy for you. Next week we will be live again. Will we, Matthew? We'll be live, I
think we will be.
But we'll be in England. This is our last show in LA.
Remember that place?
Oh, England, yes. Ah, Albany, Albion, Blighty. Ah, gin in teacups, Pete Doherty would say. What are you saying, Lawless?
Bournemouth,
yeah, we might pop down to Bournemouth, show them how it's done, liven up that gay community down there a little bit. Well, Los Angeles, oh, it's been a hell of a ride. We've had some wonderful times, haven't we, Matt?
Yes.
Can't think of any specific ones, but blimey, it's been a giddy thrill for all of us. But we're only going back to England for a couple of months. Enjoy us while we're there. Or Ponderland, we're making that. Watch out for that. That'll be an awful lot of fun for everyone. What else? Summer tour. I'm doing a big seaside tour of seaside towns. What about that, Lucy? We're going to get a tour bus. We're going to tour the country. We're going, like, just the south coast, going all around little seaside towns at the end of August.
Do that north coast. Bugger them.
Them lot. Crikey, the way they've behaved.
Both of them.
That's all. Yeah, no, those coasts can... No, yeah, that's, yeah. That's, that doesn't play a part in our plans at all. Matt, you're coming on that tour.
I'm not.
We're putting radio shows in it so that you'll have to.
Oh. No, I could be anywhere.
No, you can't, because we need to video you for our videcast. That's the new name of those.
Allowed on the
those.
Bus. I bet there's some sort of sidecar.
There'll be a little sidecar. We're going to get a shed on a skateboard to drag you about on that.
A kennel on a rope.
You'll be all right.
No wheels, just going...
And you've got to sleep on the top of it, like Snoopy.
I don't want to do that.
I'm keeping
tour.
My bits... Well, you're going on that tour.
I'm living out here with my girlfriend.
No, you... Oh, you idiot. You romantic idiot.
Yeah.
You've met an American girl.
It's ridiculous. You should see the pair of them together shuffling about, glue-sniffing. Pair of idiots. Glue-sniffing's bad. Okay, right. Lucy, would you be so kind as to read this thing. Matt, drag that down off there, mate. There's this thing that Lucy... This is how we end the show. Lucy, it's been a joy to have you. We can't let Paul McKenna do that because he'd use it as an opportunity to influence primates.
Okay.
So, here we go. Thank you very much, everyone. Thanks for the show. And now Lucy Lawless will take us out of the show.
The Russell Bland Show is a Vanity Projects production for BBC Radio 2. This is BBC Radio 2 online, on digital, and on 88 to 91 FM.